I am Richard Nockles. I'm from Surround Vision, one of the UK companies that's been brought out to South by Southwest to talk about immersive, where this is all going. Today's session, as you can see, is a documentary for the Metaverse, and that's kind of sort of a quite a clickbaity title for anything at South by Southwest. But just to explain kind of what we're going to talk about over the next hour. I'm a filmmaker, I'm a documentary maker, and I work in VR. There are a number of tools that we use to get documentary seen across XR. And really, I'm focusing on one particular project called A Brighter Future, but in the build-up towards this, I'm going to talk about the different capture techniques, or my progression over the last 10 years, and then flip over to talk about Brighter Future. It's because we're in a nice, intimate South by Southwest room. If you guys, I mean, there will be questions at the end, but if you guys have questions, I'm super chilled. So just, you know, stick your hand up and I'm happy to talk through it. So Surround Vision, we were one of the world's first specialist VR documentary teams. We set up in 2011. We're based in London. The first part of our journey was really sort of trying to understand where this was going. I mean, I got interested in VR, discovering 360 cameras, and there was this amazing Canadian company called Point Grey that was making the dodeca cameras, which were these crazy sort of science fiction looking beasts, which cost about $100,000. You couldn't get hold of them, but they made a smaller, cheaper version, and that needed to be hacked. It was kind of 11 frame rates a second. But we just started experimenting, and those first early years made us, you know, we worked with a glittering array of sort of advertising, you know, brands and National Geographic. But the process and the tools that we used really sort of pushed the boundaries. We were using drones, using zip wires.
My parents told me that they had seen greatness in me since I was small.
And I've fished these waters to provide for my family.
We need mixing CGI. So what you're looking at here is all 360 video. But it's 360 video that's been taken off the tripod, and we're mixing CGI elements as well. Now, this is obviously when you look at some of the XR projects.
I began to grow into myself and
embraced. You'll see there's a lot of stuff that's kind of moved this progression forward. But my company, Surround Vision, we're really pioneers at this. We're really looking at how we can move the camera,
how we decide to live
responsibly,
and
also start to cut between different scenes. So really sort of experimenting with the cinematic nature of what documentary can be.
Because I'm kind of a fan of breaking down barriers.
So, for example, this shot here, the compositing of the actress, you know, how we moved the camera, it was all timed dolly shots, and this shot, which I'm incredibly proud of, which is, you know, removing all of the crew, you know, post-production tools, and it really, by adopting these sort of very cinematic styles to our work, we were able to really pull audiences deeply into the which was amazing. Now, from an engagement standpoint, you know, as a filmmaker, you want your films to be seen, and there's been a big problem. I mean, the elephant in the room with VR is the audience sizes. You know, how do we engage? So YouTube commissioned us to do a series called The Female Planet, which was a very much YouTube 360 project. And that, for us, really sort of opened our eyes as into how we can engage using this. It was kind of the first project that we'd worked on that was getting the millions of views and really changing people's perceptions around the world. So that, I think, you know, it's still difficult. You know, here we are at South by Southwest. We're looking at all of this, these emerging technologies, and at the end of the day, we still need bums on seats. We still need to see, you know, how we can engage with people. And I think a big part of our journey was then, because of the work that we'd done with our documentaries and looking really, really at sort of how we can use VR for good, we were approached by the broadcaster Sky in the UK, who wanted us to kind of, like, you know, Let's see if we can apply that to some of their IP, sports, entertainment, and that really sort of blew from us as a small independent VR company. It really gave us a lot of traction. And I've got there. I mean, I was thinking what to show you guys, but this, you know, we do everything from Premier League football to boxing to F1. But this project, which was a retrospective looking at an ex Formula One champion, Damon Hill, shows this kind of convergence of multimedia. So, you know, the graphics cooked into 360 video and compositing traditional films, but also, and importantly for what I want to talk about today, the idea of theatre, because
the old girl,
when you're creating a documentary, you are creating theatre. You're effectively becoming a theatre director. You're no longer, you know, you can't do those nice cheats that we always like to use in traditional filmmaking. And so the blocking. So what you can see here, what I've done is I've obviously got the racing car driver is front and center. He's positioned about 1.2 meters away from the camera, and all of that busyness in the background. Like I had to, so you know, look at them. They're all a bunch of old engineers. I had to kind of spend half an hour with them, getting all excited. Right, you've got to move everywhere, and you've got to, you know, I've got to get you excited and kind of have you moving, because obviously the main focus of this is going to be on the F1 driver. He's talking. He's engaged. With his, but the rest of it, even though this is documentary, it's very much staged. It's very much, we're trying to kind of make the scene as alive as possible. And by cutting between, we're normally using like a 12-second cut rule, which is enough time for people to kind of get a sense of where they are. And this, obviously, what you're going to see here is this build-up towards. Him getting in the car and racing, and this is the premise of this. This is his old racing car, which is, you know, it's an absolute beast compared to kind of modern versions. But the, you know, so this is this wonderful journey, taking the audience on this journey through to see the engineers, but also out onto the track as well. So, you know, now this is, I'm kind of breaking rules with doing this, and as XR producers, if you're not supposed to normally move the camera. There are some exceptions. If you're going in a straight line, you can move the camera. But for example, just before he starts to, you know, to turn the corner, what our post-production people have been doing is checking. Now, this shot, you know, is great. You know, crazy. We had a tracking vehicle and a camera at the front of the tracking vehicle, so then we were concertinaing and completely losing the tracking vehicle. So when you're in a headset and you're floating along the track, you're there floating in space with Damon Hill kind of running around racing. You know, it's projects like this where you're mixing zip lines, drones, close proximity, choreographed work. You know, this is how you can really sort of breathe life into documentaries in 360. You know, it's brilliant. This is a really short video. I'm rubbish at preparing for these things. What you just saw there was a green screen compositing. Again, you know, as documentary makers, as creators looking at XR, you can use all the tools in the bag, and green screen is a huge opportunity to again engage and bring talent into the scene. So what we've done here is we've got our camera operator has gone off and got a static shot. 360 shot of this amazing scene when the football team won, and because we could see and analyze the gaps in this, we were able to then shoot a green screen shot with a specific camera angle at the same height, and then composite David Beckham directly into the piece. So again, you know, let's see if I can go back to that. So you can see, so I can get movement, and then compositing him into those 360 scenes is really cool as well. So then, this is brilliant being at South by Southwest. So there's so much amazing tech. I bumped into the guys from Eighth Wall last night in a bar. AR, how amazing it is to use photogrammetry to be able to take your phone out and be able to walk through scenes. Now this is a huge influence in our work at Surround Vision. in fact, or, you know, my work in general across XR, because it opens up that concept of stepping through a door, stepping through a portal into possibilities. And what we tried to do is kind of look at how we can merge our world. So you're shooting 360 video from a static video, you're then walking through a magic portal with your phone, and then you're able to look around Silverstone and feel, and as you look back, you're looking through the portal that you just walked through. It's such a simple trick. And this is, you know, this is, by the way, this is not rocket science. Like, this is old tech. I mean, it's the stuff that's happening at the moment, you know, kicks this, you know, as far as kind of web AR. It's definitely look into kind of what they're doing at Eighth Wall. It's really interesting. But the concept of kind of effortlessly tracking and being able to dive into rooms is, or different experiences is key. This is an interesting, and unrelated to XR, but it's something that I'm really interested in. Could we also translate to traditional? So can we have a traditional documentary where AR elements can fly out of the TV, out of you? So what this shot is a you know, Steadicam shot towards talent. When you use basic tracking technology and basic compositing, I mean, none of this is rocket science at all. But imagine Article 3. So imagine as the 3 starts to, as you pass into the 3. I mean, that 3 could be flying out into the room right now. So the idea of a synced experience between both traditional content and AR content is something that is huge. So capturing. I'm going to try and fly through this now. So Volcap, there's an amazing UK company, and if you don't know about them, you should definitely check them out. They're called Dimension Studios. They're based in Wimbledon. In fact, there are a load of really cool English companies that are in the space. Motion capture, volumetric capture. Effectively, it's 108 cameras in the round, and you've got enough room for the talent to perform. And those holograms are then used within the context of XR, whether it's an AR project or VR project. But it's a really amazing a piece of technology. It does have its limitations. It can be very expensive. That's a problem for documentary makers, obviously. But also the fidelity. There's some occlusions that happen within the context. So under the arms, like the chin, like the face, it's not as clean as you'd like it to be, but as with everything, you know, this is constantly evolving. So this was a project I did with the National Theatre. It's All Kinds of Limbo, which sort of, this was an artist who was talking about her, the generations from Jamaica sort of coming to the UK, and it was this amazing sort of cultural piece, which was actually produced as a VR experience where you had shared headsets, and you were in a room, and she was in the middle, and you were sort of moving around her. But it was also a sort of Pepper's Ghost experiential project, so you didn't have to have headsets on as well, which is really cool. The same company, Dimension Studios, helped myself with a Sky project. So this was a cricket project which we did last summer. This is now moving away from Volcap and towards motion capture. So this is taking the athletes, scanning their faces, and then creating avatars to then be used within the broadcast. And then what this particular piece, the client Sky created, were after the cricketers' specific moves, so when they were bowling and when they were batting. So they had to use very specialist equipment to get the hands, to get their motion capture. But this is a brilliant project, and this actually made it onto the broadcast. So these avatars were used on broadcast in AR and VR. And the reason I'm showing you this one is because it really shows kind of where this is going. It's like, where's the, you know, from being out in the cold, you know, the VR crazies, you know, we're suddenly like now being integrated into broadcast. So there are, again, there's lots of different companies that do this. I'm just picking XSense here because they've got a really robust project, product. You can see it's a suit. She's dancing around in it, and it's then translating her skeletal movement directly into game engine. So to do this, you need computer near the site, and a bunch of kind of sensors that can pick up the movement from her suit directly recorded. It's a great, we've used this for documentaries. It's a really good technique to get movement and talent into a piece. And then, of course, Unreal Engine, Epic Games are developing meta-humans. And actually, I'm not sure if you guys have been wandering around the halls, but there's loads of kind of new pop-ups, new startups looking at how to translate avatars as quickly as possible. You know, so there's, in fact, on the third floor here, you get a picture of your face and it turns directly. And I know there's one in the conference hall as well. So this kind of automation of avatars is happening at the moment. And as documentary makers, this is great. You know, anything that's going to make our lives easier to start to get talent into XR is huge. But definitely keep an eye on messy humans. I think it's there's another English company who are, as part of this trade group, who are looking at automating dialogue as well. So they're using AI with MetaHuman, which is really interesting. So now, this stuff just blows my mind. So you might have seen this at the NBA. Have come up with a whole lot of holograms of NBA matches, but this is called markerless tracking. And that term, markerless tracking, is definitely something you want to get to as documentary makers. We want to understand. This is small little GoPros. You can see on the top of the demo, they've got these tripods, and on top of them, six GoPros. And what that does is it calibrates the movements, the skeletal movements, and they use a bit of AI. This is another British company called Move.ai. Definitely check them out. They're really cool. It's calibrated cameras which translates into skeletal data, which means you can then put them in any scene you want, and you can therefore get in XR and AR and VR. It means you can move as close to the talent as possible, which is what this is all about. So I'm going to blaze through this one now. So this is a huge inspiration of mine. This is a company called Forensic Architects. They are. We worked on a project with in northern Iraq with the Yazidi people who had been, ISIS had basically come in and massacred the entire communities. And we wanted to make a documentary to raise awareness of this. So we've started, this was our first attempt at starting to move towards that walking into the story. How can you use AR portals and an adaptive mixing, 360 video, photogrammetry, and AR to start to tell a story? And it was very based around the idea of kind of effectively like a catwalk, where you walk through an AR frame, and you are then able to go into scenes. And the scenes, we used motion capture suits that you saw before in these photogrammetry scenes, which told the actual truth of what the scenes looked like. And it was absolutely brilliant. We were using so you walk through the paintings of the Yazidi artists who were screaming out for international help, and then you were able to kind of walk through the photogrammetry, and as you walked back through the frames, you would then go into 360 video. What was really interesting about this was your brain was just tricked into this believing that you were in a sixth off, which means that you can move around experience, and that was a real influence in our next project, which. Was to do with the United Nations, A Brighter Future. So throughout our journey, we've been looking at how we can use VR for good, how we can bring people closer. This project and the idea of kind of creating a framework that's, I'm aware this must look very confusing, by the way. What you're looking at here is the Sustainable Development Goals. So there are 17 icons which represent different parts of sustainability around the world: oceans, cities, farming, and so the concept that we're making is can we, rather than having people physically walk through like a catwalk like we did in Yazda, can they sit down and have these portals sweep around them? This is a really interesting concept, because by creating an interface, a 3D interface that allows you to access different types of documentary footage, it's opening up to that sort of vision of the metaverse. You know, so using UI, designing huge, the SDG icons will be blown up into a huge scale, you know, real going for like this large architectural feel that allows people to kind of explore the different areas of environmental sustainability in the world. So we pitched this to the UK government, and we've been working with the United Nations to take, you know, the idea of having a stand. So each of these chairs here, you know, is as someone sits down, they put a headset on, they're transformed into this machine, into this ability to be able to drop into different areas and different themes, and yeah, this is what we've been working on. So it's mixed documentary format, 3D photogrammetry, and dropping into 360 video, and it's represented by this sort of machine, which we're calling a brighter future, which then transports you into. So you learn about the projects, and then you can dive into the 360. It's been a really, really cool journey. Using tools like Tavori, I don't know if you guys are aware of VR tools that you can use, but you can start to. So this is all done in the headset, designed and animated. So we were able to see what the experience looked like before the developers started to build it, taking you through the different types of situations. And we did it. It's gone to the COP. It was there in Glasgow representing the UK, representing a whole load of UK companies as well. Done for a small production company to have a footprint on the world stage at a COP with presidents trying VR and experiencing what sustainability looks like, what these amazing entrepreneurs are doing around the world. You know, it really makes you appreciate the what we do as documentary makers and how we can actually touch and make change. In 2015 at the COP26, the UN asked us to make a film about the Great Green Wall, which they wanted to use Surround Vision to help raise awareness because they needed to raise funds for the Great Green Wall. And we made a 5-minute film. It got put on Obama's head, and you know all the presidents were there, you know, in the green zone, and it helped to raise $4 billion for the Great Green Wall, which went across. And I remember, you know, me and my wife were just like patting ourselves on the back, you know, because it just felt so good. And I think if there's something that you guys get out of this session, even apart from the clickbait, you know, sort of a title, documentary for the metaverse, it's that there is such an opportunity to embrace 3D within documentary. Those AR examples that I showed you, the parallaxing, the bringing, engaging and bringing people deeper into a story is really impactful. And we've seen it. We've been doing this for 10 years now, and people really resonate with it. And it's a huge opportunity. So so thank you. I'm going to stop here because I normally always talk too much and then there's no questions. And you guys are probably really interesting, and I'd love to hear from you as well. So do you guys have any questions?
The obvious question is, you know, as far as cost, mm-hmm. you know, the traditional cost, And I know, listen, the cost of a traditional documentary can vary, depending on the nature of the content.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, this is using special technology, cameras, editing, post-production work.
Yeah.
I mean, it's much more involved.
Mm-hmm.
But if you could give me an X number, like 3X, 4X,
5X. No. It's exactly, the cost-wise, it's great. The only added cost is that you need to have specialists, number one. But luckily for us now, it's evolved, and there's quite a large community of people who can help you. So if you're a producer and you want to make a VR documentary, I can introduce you to anywhere in the world. I'll know people, and in fact, actually, interesting. The XR community are here, and there are so many amazing, talented producers and directors.
So you're saying it's not that much more.
It's not that much more at all.
Cameras are pretty affordable too. GoPros and even Cisco makes
it's
a 3D camera that's
300 bucks. Yeah.
Oh wow, yeah, so better.
Yeah, the GoPro Fusions have been my go-to camera because they shoot 5.6K, and it means that you've got enough in the bag you've got enough for what we need. As in the world we live in, everyone's always after super HD, more resolution, and those cameras definitely exist as well. You just have to pay a bit more for them. I think if you want to start getting into it, if you're doing an existing documentary and you want to start to bring in VR components to it, it's very, very affordable. You know, if you've gone to the effort of setting up the scenes, of getting the contributors, of doing your work, taking a little a magic arm and a camera and just going pop, and just capturing it. That's how we all started.
I'm not in the documentary world. I actually do horror movies.
Okay.
We actually specialize, believe it or not, on film.
Okay.
But I'm trying to get our company to move to digital, and this might be a way to, VR and XR to get this.
Yeah, I've got my friend Guy Shelmadine made a brilliant VR horror movie that I'll pass you on.
Sure.
It's really good.
That'd
be great. Yeah. I mean, it's horrific. Well, no. I don't. You know, but
even better. The gore.
Yeah.
That's our special.
But you find yourself. He at one point he broke the rules, but he got away with it.
There's no rules.
Yeah, no, but there are rules in XR, which is you don't want to make, you don't make people sick. That's the thing. Like you don't want to, you don't take people round corners because your brain, you want to throw. But what he did in his film is he threw you down the stairs, and because it was so horrifying being thrown down the stairs, your brain is already going, oh fuck, I'm going down the stairs, and then so it didn't make you feel ill, which is.
Right, I'm trying to convince our management to create another.
Yeah, but do it. It's really fun. It's really.
Vinegar syndrome.
I'm sorry, you got another question?
So, first of all, I just wanted to stop and thank, as one of the three visionaries that created this environment 29 years ago, for you speaking, for you attending, for you volunteering, the camera people, thank you. Without people like you, this never would have grown into what it is.
Oh, thanks, man.
So now, I'm in a retired year, and I was wondering if we were going to get to sustainability. So now I've spent 5 years up at the UN. I'm one of the UN Ocean Ambassadors.
Amazing.
So sustainability. So if you're in this room and you want to get involved with what he was talking about, there's a thing called Ditto, which we're going to digital twin first the ocean, because the UN determined if we work on ocean and climate are the two. We got a 10-year window with those two SDGs, and we maybe can get out of this mess. So if you're looking for a place to apply your talent and help the planet, get people aware of our problems and our solutions that we have for them, I encourage all storytellers to get involved with Ditto.
Okay, I'd love to find out more, actually.
Well, you and I are going to do a mind meld here.
Ditto,
just like D-I-T-T-O. Just Google Ditto UN, and you'll find it. And there's just register, get engaged, and then just do the homework and get plugged in wherever your piece of the puzzle fits in. You know, there's all the aspects of this meta thing that's going to come. So,
can I just say one quick one? You just reminded me of something. So in our project, the Brighter Future project, so it was like we had 20 projects from around the world. And Surround Vision, so my company, we're very proud of the way that we shoot stuff. And there was one project that was from Brazil. It was a seed network. And they were like, no, we've got our own film. We don't need you to come out and film it. And I remember, like, me and the team were like, whoa, it's not going to be a very good film if it's, like, made by amateur filmmakers in a seed network in Brazil. Oh, my God, it was so good. They were so inventive and so clever. You know, all the compositing stuff that I was showing you, the static cameras and the seas, they were just absolutely amazing. So I think, you know, to your point as well, like, you know, creativity is you know, that's what we live for, you know. These tools, the cameras, the tools, the post-production techniques, you know, as long as you stick with the don't make people sick rule, you know, that's the key. But it was, you know, to your point, I guess, with Disso, you know, there will be hundreds of activists who can take these cameras and go off and, I mean, that's what we want to do with this project, you know. And in fact, I'm here at South by Southwest trying to, you know, rub shoulders with, you know, I'm not specifically looking for Meta, but, you know, someone who has a big platform who can reach voices. And, you know, it was really interesting talking to the eighth wall people yesterday who are looking at AR, and, you know, and it made my brain was just like, well, actually, yeah, well, why have it in VR? It should be readily open to anyone with a mobile phone, you know. So yeah, I'm making this stuff up as I go on. I'm just trying to do some good. I'm just trying to do some good in the world with the tech that we have. But does anyone have, we got 5 minutes? So
well, okay, there's one other thing. So the other piece, the bigger piece, is Burning Man. 2 years ago, took a 12-year-old in Roblox, mentored him. He created 4 sustainable worlds at Burning Man. They had to go virtual like we had to, blah, blah, blah. But the number of people that put on VR head glasses for the first time so they could, they were burners, but they weren't VR. They had to have their kids show them how to do VR so they could be Burning Man. And all of these people got involved in the sustainable world because they came to this youth state. Mm. And that's where the light bulb went. So we're going to gamify the SDGs using the ocean first. And the beauty part of the ocean for everyone is the visual eye candy the ocean provides. Mm. So you can capture so many of that, at least for those few seconds, that maybe now your message gets a little bit further. Now your story grabs them and they go on through the whole experience. So it's an environment for storytellers to use this thing. Help us get this to kindergartners to 25-year-olds, because that's where they live in these VR glasses. If you can help us tell that story for the planet, thank you.
Cool. Thank you.
Yeah, well, none of this is about the purpose, not about problems. We've got an ailing life support system.
Does anyone, that I'm going to harass you later, so definitely. but how about any other questions, technical? Oh, yes.
Do you have any cool upcoming projects that involve some of this technology that you've been doing for sustainability?
All the stuff that we do at Surround Vision is geared towards that. Are you looking for like a specific project? I think like it was weird that the gentleman's mentioning oceans, because there's a project we're working on with a deep sea team called Necton, who are scanning the ocean, and there, so that's a great use of animation, photogrammetry, and data. I think that's a big part of kind of where this is fitting in as well. Certainly, how we can use real time data. And have these adaptive, interactive moments could be huge as well. So, I don't quite know how to answer your question because I'm in it at the moment. Like, right. It's just, you know, it's. Do you work in sustain?
No.
You sound like you want to get involved. So,
no,
like,
I'm just trying to absorb all the.
Oh, I see. Yeah, yeah.
It's very cool stuff.
Cool. Well, anyone else? Any other questions?
I'm just curious how you set up these collaborations. Know which of the companies that's best fit. So can you talk a bit about how you built your network?
Yeah, thank you. Well, luckily, because we started in 2011, we were the pioneers in this little fish pond. So, you know, we went to the conferences, and we're like this, I've been going to conferences for 10 years, and you just rub shoulders with people. And I think a lot of there's a hunger for new technology. There's a hunger for trying things differently, creatively, and also from a commercial standpoint as well. And Silicon Valley are constantly trying to imagine how to engage with and retain audiences. And so they are. The money, let's face it, it's all down to money when you're a documentary maker. You know, it's easier to get money when you're doing these experimental projects, which could potentially help these bigger platforms to kind of do their thing. I think certainly with Oculus, there are a lot of the pioneers are here at South by Southwest, and you know, the likes of Facebook, Google, Microsoft. You know, they've really been helping. And through those networks, we then get to, because we have the money, we can then reach out to the charities who work across the environmental space. So when you go to COP, you know, you've got, I mean, with the first, when we did that project with in Senegal with the Great Green Wall, we had comms teams from the UN coming up to going, how did you do that? You know, like, because it was amazing. You know, we did, because we were transporting people and doing something differently. And brighter future. I mean, look at the title, A Brighter Future. It's not, we're trying to move away from doom and gloom and trying to offer, you know, some positivity to this. You know, I mean, I personally believe, foolishly or not, but the humans are clever. We can get ourselves out of this. We just need to come together. And so projects like this and conversations like this, you know, are really important. We can, you know, try and galvanize. I was in a bar last night talking to an American. He's like, you idiot. Yeah, but you know, it's like, No. He was saying, you know, he's skeptical. It's easy to be skeptical and fall down negativity. And I guess I'm overly optimistic. I think we can find a solution.
First I hear you were actually behind us in line at Speakeasy, and I was going to butt into your conversation. But I always do that, so I withheld myself.
Oh, wow, cool.
I was interested in your conversation.
Well, nice.
Yes, but I withheld.
It's fun at South by Southwest. Yes. You can't.
You were right behind us. Not Speakeasy, the one after that.
Oh, right, cool. Yeah. I love it. My line in South by Southwest is, would you like to talk to a stranger? And everyone's like, yeah, I'd love to talk to a stranger. You know. So, anyway, I'm out of time. It's been really lovely I can continue. Really? That's great. Okay, well, I can continue. Yeah. So what else comes? So are you guys all documentary?
Yeah, I have a question. You said that was a stadium or blocking the scenes, like theater,
yeah,
directing, right?
Yeah.
How much time that adds to the process, right?
Yeah, it's...
Because in documentary, it's a commission piece. Yeah. It only has 6 months. Yeah. Already on a traditional piece.
Yeah.
How much time the blocking is going to take?
Very good question. And also, thank you for asking the question, because I can also tell you, I need to impart my latest theory as well. So when we first started, and many people do this as well, in 360, you want to fill the entire scene. So if you put the camera in the middle of the room, you know, how do we, where, like if we're filming this scene, for example, where would the camera be? And typically, like in the olden days, I'd like put it somewhere in the middle because, that makes sense. You're on that side, I'm on this side. It's great. But actually, that's incredibly frustrating from an audience perspective, because if their head is just here, they're either looking at me, and that's a very boring experience. And then if they want to turn around, well, you guys are just doing. So actually, you really want to put the audience kind of here, so they can sort of see me and you at the same time. And so when it comes to blocking, you really want to kind of try and focus on that the 180 around, that close proximity where you know that they're going to be looking. Because having done this for 10 years, yes, they look around. They'll look around in the headset and look behind them. But you know, maybe at the beginning, at the end of the thing, they're really focused on where you're looking. And from an editorial perspective, what we do is we mix up the scenes. So we do composed shots cut with documentary footage. So for example, if you're shooting a scene in, you know, about Formula One, you'll have this very rich crowd. The crowds are out, you know, there's big scenes, there's, you know, the flags are flying. If you cut that with an engineering shot with a team while doing it, it feels like it's live and it's real. So the majority, I'd say 80% of the shots that we do in a documentary are actual documentary shots where you're stealing shots from a from a crowd, and it's the compositive ones, those composed ones that really give it that full flavour, and it makes it feel more real. So it does add a bit of time, but it's definitely worth doing it. Does that answer the question?
Yeah. So you said you started in 2011. Mm-hmm. How did you get into this space?
The camera. So the Canadian camera that I told you, the Dodeca camera, was very expensive. But there was another smaller point grey camera called the Ladybug camera. That's it. Mm-hmm. And there was you couldn't get it anywhere in Europe. And then I did Google search, and there was this Dutch company, and I wrote to them, I called them, they never returned my calls, and so I just got on the plane and went up to Northern Holland, and I wrote to them and said, look, I'm coming, this English bloke's going to come and knock on your door, and they couldn't believe it, yeah, so they knocked on the door, and they were like, hey, Englishman, you know, and they were just like, and so I convinced them over many beers, the Dutch are brilliant, over many beers to let me take one of these cameras back to the UK. And that was it. I was the one person in the UK with one of these 360 cameras. And, you know, all of advertising agencies were just like all over me. So that was it. And I did work in advertising for about 2 years with that camera, kind of like, you know, and then very quickly realized I hate advertising. So I then went back, but then focused back onto my documentary. You know, so it was definitely right place at right time, and seeing the tech and just going, I want to play with that,
yeah.
I want to do that.
I'm going to get that camera.
Yeah, exactly. And it is. I mean, I shoot all of my kids and family holiday. I mean, all my family just can't, you know, but it is brilliant because I've got, you know, amazing footage of my family. So you could start with that. You know, you can start pretty easily. That's my advice, going from brighter future to do your kids' videos. But it is fun, you know, I definitely recommend it. It's really, it's a great community of friendly folk. And certainly if you have any questions, you can always reach out to me as well. I can help you, point you in the right direction, so.
Does the end use always require glasses, or?
Well, this is the thing. So with Margarita in hand last night, I have been in a state of confusion at South by Southwest because of this whole Web3 and Layer 2 and crypto this and crypto that. And I'm just like, what is going on? And then I bumped into this, seemed like a 25-year-old developer from 8th Wall. And he just whipped out his phone and showed me the latest web AR. And it just was like a slap in the face because it was just like, oh my God, you know, all of that distraction. You know, we're content makers. We want to reach people. And there's the tools. So Web 2, all the tools we have at the moment can reach massive, massive numbers. So yes, VR is restricted because you need to have a headset. But if you create, and this is what I was been hoping, I'm clearly hoping that I could show you, is that it's this merging of AR tools and portals and mixed media that allows you to kind of create these journeys that you can kind of walk through with a mobile phone, and that's the key. So, you know, the VR, and everyone who works in VR is you know, it's like the emperor's new clothes, isn't it? It's like we're all kind of going, it's great, you know. But it is, you know, it's annoying that we can't show our work. So, you know, you have to have a VR headset. So I think AR definitely unlocks it. And it's almost, we see it as a gateway to that sort of those richer experiences as well. And you know, who knows? I mean, the hardware manufacturers like Apple and Microsoft, we know that they're developing mixed reality glasses. So, you know, very soon we'll have a much more convenient use of mixed reality, and that will then open up even further opportunities for storytellers like us. Are you guys all documentary makers? You're not, no? Are you just like going, what's going on? Are you like me in the Web3 conversation?
I was wondering what you're showing.
Oh, okay, good, yeah.
Just walked in.
Nice, nice. Well, good. All right, cool.
No, I do brick and mortar retail, so.
All right, nice. I think what's interesting is the depth cameras. So that we're now, in fact, you know, there's my favorite thing that I've seen in this building is this Canadian artist called Vincent. if you go to the XR thing, I think it's on the third floor, he's got this piece called Composition, and it's where he's got these little wooden blocks. And have you seen it?
Yeah.
It's just amazing. And he's got these projectors. He's got one camera, a machine vision camera, looking at the blocks. And as you move them, you've got headphones on, and he's got this live projection system, and it's VR without VR glasses. It's absolutely amazing, and it's just a single one camera just looking at the movement of these blocks, and a clever algorithm which changes the music, and this incredible projection. You've got to go and check it out. For me, it represents this opening of the, this the restrictions of kind of having a headset on.
First of all, I love the work you do.
Thanks.
So I'm a filmmaker. I'm in the conservation business, so wildlife conservation.
Oh, cool.
Sustainability. David Attenborough. So, but now my boss, my CEO, he's turning 60. So he will ask me, I've been doing traditional documentary for decades now. It works. Why would I do something like this in the conservation world?
Mm.
I would totally love to do that.
Mm.
But what would I tell him? Because seriously.
It's difficult, yeah.
Because we're playing on the platforms without documentaries.
Yeah.
So who would be giving us money for that?
Well, Nat Geo, really interesting. I mean, there are lots of broadcasters the commissioners are really interested in it, and certainly because of this crossover of augmented reality as well, and greater reach, you can definitely start it's one of those things. You've just got to try it. You know, I've done quite a bit of natural history. It's really difficult. You know, trying to get the meerkat to stand near the camera is quite hard. It's quite hard. Yeah. But then there's tricks, aren't there? You know, there's plenty of trained meerkats, and there's like trained swans, and you can get the, you know, there's ways to get the, to our point, you know, compose shots mixed with that true actuality and to bring presenters in. There's an amazing company called Black Dot Films, who do a lot of work with Nat Geo. And they're definitely worth checking out. They are incredible filmmakers in natural history, and they are as far as kind of pioneers in rule breaking and trying different things. You'd do well just to kind of have a look at some of their stuff. It's really amazing. It's all about proximity. You want to take the camera is a person's head, so you want to take the person's head as close to the action as possible. So it's tricky. It's definitely tricky. Zip wires are just so cool though, because they're running between two trees and taking them over a scene. It's really, really cool. Like, thank you all. I really honestly thought I was going to be by myself. Just to
it's always a fear.
So yeah, exactly. So thank you so much. You've been great. Thank you.